This evening on The Rock Newman Show, I chat with supermom and best-selling author Darlene Brooks. Darlene breaks down how she's raised four exceptional children despite two divorces and experiencing domestic violence abuse. Darlene also shares how she's teaching single moms the formula for effective parenting and why truth and self-esteem play a huge part in rearing happy and whole children. That's coming up right now on The Rock Newman Show. Welcome to The Rock Newman Show from the campus of historic Howard University, located in the nation's capital. I'm Rock Newman, and it is my desire to inspire you with personal stories of extraordinary achievement. Darlene Brooks is motherhood personified, a supermom to the core. Darlene has raised four children who are successfully maneuvering through the world of music, dance, journalism, philanthropy, public speaking, business, and more. She joins me now to break down how she's maintained healthy relationships with her kids despite two divorces, a domestic violence abuse, and she'll also share some parenting tools found in her book, A Mother's Manual. Darlene, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Rock.
Also joining Darlene are her amazing daughters, Treasure, Bianca, and Crystal. Welcome to the show. Should I say gals?
Ladies.
There you go. Thank you so much for being here. Y'all came from all different parts. Came from Nashville. Crystal came from, flew in from Nashville. You all took the train down from New York. And yeah. Darlene flew in from San Francisco.
Yeah.
And now we're all here.
And it's nice to be together with my children, especially to be here with you, Rock. I haven't seen you in a while.
It's been a long time. I'm glad I could play a role in helping to get the family together.
Thank you.
Darlene, you wrote a book. Yes, you did.
Yes, I did.
It's called A Mother's Manual by Darlene Brooks. The very first thing you say is, say the words, I love you to your children every chance you get. You opine these simple yet powerful three words serve as food and music for their soul and can never be heard too much. What prompted you to write that?
First of all, because it's something that I do. I started writing these passages with just things that came into my head, and I know it was just all spirit-driven, because I started with 31 passages 5 years ago, and I thought, I'll write something for mothers for a month. But that's just first. Just make sure that they know that you love them, first and foremost. And I've talked to older mothers and younger mothers who have never been told that by their mother.
Yeah.
And I was shocked, but I know now that it's an absolute truth. Yeah. Every child is not told I love you by their parent.
Yeah. You know, I have a great nephew who a family member passed when he was 36 years old. And somewhere leading up to the funeral, he revealed that the person that the gentleman that died, his family member that died, was the only male person that had ever told him, I love you.
It's very common. It's more common than you can imagine. And it's sad, but it is food for the soul. I mean, we all love to be told and that we're loved.
You know what? I'm going to keep this very basic, this first foray here into having you guys to speak up. Your mom telling you that she loved you, what do you feel, what did it mean to you, and how did it feel when she was saying it? And let's just go down the list here. Treasure?
Well, I think having that sort of affection verbalized, I think that often parents, they demonstrate their love in many ways, whether it be just, you know, the custodial aspect of being a parent, picking them up, making dinner. But I think so often in our society, we don't hear those words. And those actions, as meaningful as they are verbalizing them, it concretizes them. And it allowed for me to go out into the world knowing like there is someone who sincerely loves me. Mm-hmm. And there's no doubt about it. There's no questioning that.
Yeah.
And it also, it really made me become a person that wanted to make sure I was demonstrating affection to others mm-hmm. in very concrete ways.
Mm-hmm.
And leave no ambiguity in my feelings, whether it be like really passionate emotion or really really strong frustration, anger, whatever it was. My mother was always definitely a prime example of being vulnerable and being open with how you feel. And I think she began that through her verbalizing her love for her children.
You're still in high school.
Yes.
Did I hear you say custodial and yeah. concretizing and ambiguity?
And she's a bibliophile.
Huh?
She's a bibliophile.
A bibliophile?
They all are.
Uh-huh.
But she is especially.
Okay, so you're 18 years old and a senior in high school.
Yeah, I just turned 18.
Yeah, we'll come back to the school that you attend in just a moment. Bianca?
Yeah, I would say that it was always reassuring to hear I love you. I mean, especially in your adult life, because it's something that mothers say a lot to their kids, mm-hmm. I think, when they're children.
Mm-hmm.
But my mom has been ever consistent in saying I love you, in expressing that verbally. But at the same time, I think that it's meant a lot more when she showed it, because I mean, I have a lot of friends who have immigrant parents and like just parents from all over the world. Like I have Haitian friends, Pakistani friends, mm-hmm. and saying I love you is a very American concept. It's like constantly verbalizing your love. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I have one of my best friends is Syrian, and she told me that her father never used to say I love you,
yeah.
but he always fed his children fruit.
Uh-huh.
Like he would come up to them to the mouth and like feed them fruit. And like
yeah.
she never really understood that that was his way of saying I love you until like she rejected it and she could see how hurt that he was. And
uh-huh.
so I think that understanding that love comes in so many languages besides that of like spoken
mm-hmm.
word. And when my mom, she showed those, and I think that the thing is that it was not just her saying, I love you, but there was so many other ways that she showed and said, I love you, you know,
yeah.
take care of yourself, like cover yourself when you leave the house. Like, you know, these
mm-hmm.
things that she did to enrich our spirit
mm-hmm.
were the things that carried me through more than I love you. Because I mean, I sort of walked past a girl at my school just the other day, and her mom had just dropped her off at school with groceries. And her mom said, I love you. And the girl, she said, I'll see you later, mom. Like she didn't really respond to it.
Yeah.
And I just thought about like the fact that her mom was even bringing her groceries. Like these acts of love, like acts,
yeah.
love as a doing thing,
uh-huh.
not as a saying thing, has uh-huh. always meant more for me.
Mm-hmm.
And so the times when my mom has showed me love, honestly have, and it's so funny because I'm a writer and I write about love a lot,
uh-huh.
and yet, words, they don't mean nearly as much to me as actions.
As behavior.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Right.
Okay, so I mentioned that Treasure was still in high school.
Yeah.
Bianca attends Columbia University. Let me just say to my viewers here, I often have said that motherhood is the single most important obligation in the human experience. And we are a couple of days away from Mother's Day. And so we took particular attention and made efforts to bring to you a show that celebrates motherhood. How better to celebrate motherhood than to bring a mother who's written a book talking about a mother, and it's a mother's manual, and the example of her daughter. So Bianca is at Columbia University, and you're rather modest, as are the young ladies, about what they do. But let me just tell you, Bianca is the youngest opinion writer in the history of the New York Times, and it's not a one-time thing. She has a deal with them. She has a contract. Bianca has written opinion pieces that have appeared on the front page of the New York Times. Way to go, Mom. Way to go, Bianca.
I give it to her.
Sitting next to Bianca is Crystal. We'll talk about you a little bit while I embarrass you a little bit later. But your reflection on hearing your mom say, I love you often.
For me, it's just, it's become a matter of habit. And I know that she's instilled that in all of us. It's like, no matter how mad we are, every phone conversation is going to end with, okay, I love you, bye, you know? So yeah, it's just been a matter of habit. And just like Bianca was saying, the consistency of it throughout our lives, and how she's shown it in her actions more than anything. Mm-hmm. I know that I've grown to know how similar we are, and being able to come to her knowing that she's not going to judge, and that's what her love means to me, you know?
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Darlene, when we were contemplating doing this show, one of the factors that had us to reach out to you to ask you to participate was your life ain't been no bed of roses.
No.
As we said in the opening, you know what? Before I go there, you guys laugh. Tell me why you laughed.
Because it's true.
It's too true.
What comes to mind when you say it?
Thorns.
It wasn't even like not a bed of roses. It wasn't like a bed of concrete. It was like rough. Mom's life was rough.
How do you describe how you're in a position? There are many people who have had some of the difficulties and the challenges that you have had, and they have used that as an excuse simply not to be responsible, not to be productive. They've used it, some of the challenges that you have endured, to make excuses for their failures. You've done the opposite. Where does it come from within your being to have turned that around?
I know specifically exactly where it comes from. I know something that I was told at one of the hardest times in my life, when I was having trauma in the home, and I confided in a dear friend, and I told him what was happening in my home. And he told me, he said, "Darlene, sometimes when you're under attack, it's not about you. Sometimes it could just be the enemy's way of trying to stop the destiny of your children." And I never forgot that. And I just thought, I'm going to push through no matter what, just to see where they're supposed to go, because they didn't ask to come here. Mm-hmm. You know, we choose to have children. You don't have to have a baby. You don't have to have a child. Right. But I chose to be a mother. I waited until I was almost 30. My son is 27.
Yeah.
And I just knew that I had to see through every challenge, every problem. Every time I fell down, I had to get back up. Not for me, but for them. Mm-hmm. To see them through. Because I really realized that I had no idea who I was raising. Nobody knows who they've given birth to. You don't know who they're gonna be.
Yeah.
You don't know what they're here to do. And I just felt that was my responsibility, for them to get through, make it over, overcome, and keep going. And I really wanted to break a lot of things generationally, not just on my side of the family, mm-hmm. but on their father's side of the family. I felt like I wasn't just raising children. I felt like I was trying to shift some things so that they would never have to go through some things that I'd gone through, that their children and their children's children will never have to repeat some of these generational cycles and strongholds.
You know what? Let's get into it. I start off every show by saying I hope to inspire you, and I'm talking about the audience out there. Hope to inspire you with stories of extraordinary achievement. And I think one form of inspiration is for my viewing audience to be aware. You said some of the things you've gone through. Mm-hmm. So because I think it is so easy to identify. You know, when folks look in here and they see superstars on this stage, you know, they see an author and they see, you know, these kids who are doing, young ladies who are doing incredible things, that's one thing. That's mm-hmm. one form of inspiration. Mm-hmm. To know what a mother has been through, if you, again, I don't want you to share something that's beyond so embarrassing you don't want to share it, but if you can share some of the lows.
Yeah, you know, I don't ever feel embarrassed because I know that for one, I've gone through. And for two, I can't help anybody else if I don't let them know, because I've been told so many times, even at Abyssinian Baptist Church, I stood up to talk about myself. And the deacon said, in my 30 years of teaching this class, I've never heard a testimony like that, because you don't look like you've been through any of that. And I can start with A to Z. I mean, I've just put it out there. I did go through the experience of domestic violence. I don't wear it on my sleeve because I've gone through it, over it, and was healed in so many ways. I took counseling and took them through counseling for healthy relationships after that happened.
So you went through domestic counseling that they witnessed?
Yeah, we went to Overcomers meetings every Monday night for 2 years after I left home. We were in a shelter. I think I called you that summer. I was in a shelter with them in the summer of 2002, for the whole summer, in the backwoods of North Carolina, where I fled in a minivan from our home in Chicago. I've been very, very ill, where I had surgery. I had complications after surgery, and I was paralyzed. And I had to, Bianca helped me get up to walk in the hospital. They thought I was gonna die. I didn't get up for a few months to walk again, and I had to wear funny orthopedic shoes for a while, but hey, God,
step in there.
You know,
I want to
bankruptcy, underemployment. When Crystal was born, I lived in a house. I had a nanny. I had a housekeeper. We had a house so big in the valley in Southern California that it had one address on one side, another address on the back street, 6 cars in the driveway. By the time they graduated from high school, we had an EBT card, and it wasn't enough to feed us by the end of the month. So, I mean, I've had a life of peaks and valleys, and I grew up upper middle class black, which is almost a curse to me, because you almost don't really understand that, you know, what it is.
I grew up
in the suburbs of the Bay Area. I was born in Oakland and grew up in El Cerrito. Mm-hmm. And it just very oblivious to the things and, you know, how things actually happen, and learned a whole lot the hard way, because I was always adventurous and pretty wild. That's why I didn't have kids till I was almost 30.
Let me ask the ladies. I know you guys were young when she talked about being in the shelter. Do you all recollect any of that time in the shelter in North Carolina?
Yeah, all of it.
All of it.
Yeah.
Crystal, why?
I started second grade there, and I remember just being very fearful of the whole experience. And I told my teacher I went by my middle name, Autumn, because I don't know, we were told not to, you know, speak too much or tell people where we were from. And so I went by Autumn, and but it was my first time really using my middle name. And so when she would call on me in the class, I wouldn't answer. And people were like, what is wrong with this girl?
Yeah.
Why is she not answering to her name? I don't know. It was absolutely memorable.
I can't remember. I think that, honestly, it's my first recollection of a life, like, to be honest. Like, when I think about it, like, I was like 5 or 6. I was starting first grade, and I remember my first grade teacher, but I don't really remember too much before that. Mm. I mean, we moved there from Chicago, where my father's parents live, but and I remember a bit of Chicago, but when I think about my life as it started, because from North Carolina, where we lived in that shelter, we moved to Atlanta, and like, I consider myself from Atlanta, and like, that's where I really got my childhood, and like, where I remember girlhood starting. And when we were in the shelter, there were these two older girls who watched us And I remember that was the first time we ever ate ramen noodles.
We thought they were so delicious.
And we had a bunch of seasoning salt on them. We thought they were the most delicious food. And I just remember, when I think about my memories of girlhood, they started there because we were surrounded by so many women who had so many different stories. And I remember there was this old white woman who, she would sit out front in front of the shelter with a shotgun talking about how her husband was going to come and get her. Mm-hmm. And so when I think about my earliest recollections of woman and girlhood, they started in that shelter. So, I'll never forget it, ever.
I think, I was very young. I was 3 years old. But, my memories are fragmented. But even just that memory of the woman on the porch, I remember
Miss
that.
Barbara.
And ramen noodles, I remember putting ice cubes in them to cool it down. I remember monkeys in a barrel. And I have a really distinct memory of the shelter, which was there was a room with a globe on it and it has gloves underneath. And kids weren't allowed in this room. And Crystal told me it was illegal for kids under 5 to touch the globe. And I remember so badly wanting to touch it and spin it. And so I remember sneaking out of bed one night and putting my hand on the globe. And I think it was Miss Barbara found me, and I got a whooping for that. I distinctly remember that.
I remember now. That's my first memory of singing, is in that home. You guys remember we used to watch Aladdin every day, pretty much. And I remember singing, what's the song?
A Whole New World.
Right. And I would just walk around the kitchen singing A Whole New World. And I remember you were like, Crystal, stop singing through your nose. That doesn't sound good. And I'm like. I'll fix it. I'm going to work on it.
I don't know if you know it or not, but we've got some footage of Crystal singing, and you ain't singing through your nose.
No.
Can we go to that? We're sitting here talking to Miss Fisk University.
Yes, sir.
Now, was there a talent show part, and was that part of how you got there?
There's a pageant, and then there are student votes. But yes, I sang an original song that me and my sister wrote together called Paradise. So, yeah.
You sang Paradise?
Yes,
she's
ma'am.
Paradise.
We haven't
Girl,
even
I
really
didn't
talked
even
about
know that.
It, but I sang Paradise.
And you have some 2017 opinions and views about HBCUs and women's roles at HBCUs, which caused you a little bit of an issue on campus. I don't know whether that was with the administration or just who. Rather than my trying to characterize it, can you share a little bit about what those views are?
Yeah, well, it was definitely something that was well talked about earlier in the semester. My school's motto is forever on the altar, and my campaign platform was evolution on the altar. And I pretty much just discussed throughout my week how by modifying the image of people like Ms. Fisk, those ambassadors of HBCUs, to women that look like the women that are on campus. It's more inspiring for teenage girls that, we're reaching out to come to HBCUs. And I just think it's all around more embodying of what a black woman looks like today. I'm not necessarily sure about the culture at Howard, but I know that Fisk University has always been very traditional and conservative, and they make it a very big deal to share those values with the freshman incoming, that a woman is very poised, a woman is quiet, a woman dresses a certain way, and that just has not been very reflective of my experience at Fisk. And so that's, I know, the image that they sell to young people trying to get to come to Fisk, but I know that the women around me that I go to school with every day, that's not what our Fisk experience has been like. We dress, however we feel, and we're very outspoken, and we're activists, and I just want the university to take a step forward and realize that it's not a bad thing to change. It's okay to stand upon that platform of tradition, but I know that Fisk especially is here because of change, and so learning to walk with that and not veer away from thinking things are too radical, or, you know, that's not feminine
and
enough.
And so that platform was met with some resistance?
A little bit. I mean, there was a, students were absolutely enthusiastic about it, just because the Miss title at university, HBCUs, is typically very conservative. And just showing them that I'm even running for this position and I'm going to do it in my own way, I feel was very inspiring for the students on campus.
Bianca, you wrote about education. Mm-hmm. One of the pieces that was on the front page was about education. You want to share a little bit about your thoughts and what you were thinking when you wrote that op-ed piece?
Yeah.
That, let me say again, that appeared on the front page of the New York Times.
That op-ed
when
was
you were
about,
19 years old.
That op-ed, that op-ed was just about, it was about my love for reading and how when I, and like how I entered college, like considering some kind of major in journalism or English, but realizing that I go to such an expensive school, like my tuition is over $250,000, but I'm on a full ride. And that honestly, I was told a lot that it would be a waste of an education, of an Ivy League education, to pursue an English degree or any kind of humanities degree. And so just trying to find ways around like the university system, which insists upon making the most out of your education in like a monetarily valuable way, just because we grew up poor and like people don't really, I mean, people like to say, you know, lower middle class or whatever, but we grew up poor. Mm-hmm. And I graduated high school working two jobs, and like I still work like in college and to pay my bills, to, you know, and the New York Times is not paying my bills, so I just want to say that too. Mm-hmm. Like, you know, worked in offices, work in stores, work in restaurants, like those sorts of things. Like those are the kind of jobs that I've done and that we've done to get by. And so it's unrealistic for me to sit around and tell people, you know, young girls, they ask me constantly, they actually do, like, you know, how do you do what you do and how do you afford whatever? Like, how do you afford your life? Like, mm-hmm. these sorts of things. And I have to tell them, like, I work a lot, you know, and like jobs that have nothing to do with art and nothing to do with personal expression, because mm-hmm. that's the nature of the situation. And like that's Columbia, I think part of the thing is that they tell you that it's going to be one way when you enter an Ivy League school, especially as a poor black kid who has done amazing things, because when I was in high school I worked for NPR and like that was sort of the selling point for Columbia. And so they kind of bring you in and they say, oh, you know, now that you're so special, you're going to be okay for the rest of your life. And you have a bunch of other kids that enter these schools, Ivy League universities, thinking that they're going to be set too. And it's like, okay, but if you become a doctor or a lawyer, if you pursue a professional degree, like, you know, poor black kids don't just get dreams.
Yeah.
It's not like everybody else.
Not automatic.
No, yeah. Not automatically, and still not. And like, still as we sit here, not, you know, I graduate next year and, you know, I'll probably have like good job prospects, but not for writing, like not for, you know, painting, none mm-hmm. of the things that, you know, I love to do, because that's not what the purpose of an education is, to alleviate poverty. Mm-hmm. And while, you know, if you're rich and you're white and you're wealthy, you can do other things and you can afford to pursue your dreams without the risk of, you know, economic failure or with the help of your parents, then that is nice. But for Columbia, yeah, I study econ and human rights law, so.
Yeah. Treasure, not for the purpose of name dropping, mm-hmm. but I want to go somewhere with this. The school you attend, it's called the Master's School.
Yeah.
It's in Westchester County, mm-hmm. in New York. Mm-hmm. Darlene, you can drop the names, and then I want to come back and ask Treasure something about the family kids who go there.
I really don't even want to drop the names, because it's...
But it's purposeful, though.
It's purposeful to say that at our spring gala a few weeks ago at the auction, we auctioned off time to spend dinner with Henry Kissinger. That went for $70,000. A parent got that.
Mm-hmm.
Chris Rock did a video, and he offered a time with him backstage.
His kids go there.
He did a video. and his kids went backstage.
Can I interject? Mm-hmm. So just to gauge, like, I guess, the how elite my school is,
yeah.
my best friend freshman year. Her father was the president of MasterCard. Numerous Wall Street investors and bankers.
Martin Scorsese,
Catherine Zeta-Jones, if we're gonna do it. So there's definitely an appeal to the school for artistic families. Mm-hmm. There are a lot of directors. A director for Law and Order, his kids go there. So yeah, it's.
And so what was your hurdle getting there? What did you have to do to compete to get in there? One. Mm-hmm. And two, if you could give us a sense of you're there with these kind of uber wealthy people mm-hmm. coming from a background that is much different than theirs, how do you see them and how do you think they see you?
Well, first off, the way that I got into the school, I used a gateway program, and these are very common for impoverished students of color. It's called a Better Chance, and essentially what it does is it expedites the reviewing process of your application, and it ensures that your financial needs will be met for any school that accepts you. Mm-hmm. I knew off the bat that I wanted to go to the master's school because geographically, it's just a prime location. You get this Westchester County, it's suburban, but it's a 30-minute train ride to the city. And I had gone to performing arts school since I was 5 years old. Mm-hmm. So in my mind, by being so close, I would be able to get that academic rigor that the school provided mm-hmm. in a safe environment, mm-hmm. while simultaneously being able to go into the city and audition and build an artistic life for myself there that wasn't stifled by that suburban environment. And I got in, I was offered a full ride throughout my 4 years at Masters. I've been given additional scholarships for my dancing. So a Better Chance gateway programs. Those are really how you do it. Mm-hmm. And I was accepted to other schools as well, but I knew I wanted to go there. Mm-hmm. And then in regards to, you know, having such a foreign experience in the environment I'm in, it was really difficult. I think that we lived in Georgia and then we lived in Oakland mm-hmm. and directly where we lived was predominantly Black. Mm-hmm. So I was constantly met with reflections of myself. I was constantly represented in the classroom, in my friend groups. I never was ostracized, and my identity as a Black girl was never an anomaly. Mm-hmm. It was always commonplace. Mm-hmm. And then I go to private school in Westchester County with these incredibly wealthy people. I don't wanna say that it was the first time I really knew that I was Black,
yeah.
But it was definitely the first time that I understood the implications to Blackness in mm-hmm. white spaces. Mm-hmm. And I was met by that when I was 13, 14 years old, which is very early. And it's some things that my friends back in Oakland, they still don't understand. And mm-hmm. it's still the reason that they're met with such difficulty and when they exit their space in Oakland, you know, when they're going about the college process,
yeah.
it's incredibly difficult for them because their world is not diversified in that way.
Yeah.
And they don't have a white gaze on them. Mm-hmm. To their knowledge, they do, but to their knowledge in their space, they're comfortable, mm-hmm. they're isolated. But I really used that to my advantage. It took me a while. I told people I was from San Francisco instead of Oakland for yeah. my first 2 years there.
Yeah.
When people asked me what my parents did, I tried to be as vague as possible.
Sure.
But then I realized what a beautiful thing it is to be in a space where literally no one is like you.
Yeah.
You know, I don't need to fight to be exceptional. I am the exception.
Uh-huh.
You know, and I use that to my advantage by I had the ability to speak on issues that everyone else could only read about. And mm-hmm. everyone else, no one could mm-hmm. attest to mm-hmm. the things that they were talking about in these discussions about poverty and about race mm-hmm. and about gender norms and all of these things. They weren't living them, they were researching them.
Mm-hmm.
And I had lived them at such a young age. And so I brought that into my discussions, and I very proudly told people I'm from Oakland, California. I was raised by a single mother. Mm-hmm. I lived in homeless shelters growing up.
Yeah.
Even now, when I go home for break, I don't always know where it is that I'm going.
Yeah.
But it really gave a validity to the things that I was saying. I was a primary source
mm-hmm.
For these experiences, and in such a racially charged time, the Black Lives Matter movement was at its emergence mm-hmm. when I first came into school. Mm-hmm. You know, those experiences were like powerful
this
to be able to talk about.
This
you know?
Wasn't theory stuff.
It
this,
wasn't. It
this
wasn't.
Yeah, but let me intervene because this is so interesting. Yeah. I think that it's fascinating because while it's like served as validation for your experiences going to this boarding school, it's changed our family dynamic because it's so different. Treasure has grown up in her teenage years so differently than Crystal and I grew up in our teenage years because I went to a high school in the middle of the ghetto, like shout out to Oakland Tech, but you know, where Marshawn Lynch went to high school, by the way. And you know, I mean, I had 27 absences, like 43 tardies, and still gave like my high school speech. Like I was still the class speaker for my high school. Like the bar was so low in a lot of ways. And like, you know, most kids, they didn't graduate a lot. Like my, like one of my closest high school friends was killed last year. He was stabbed to death. And the thing is like having that reality of people who just didn't make it, like out of your high school, like it was growing up in poverty real time, but as a young adult rather than just a child and like constantly being out. And while I'm really glad that Treasure got out of that before us, it was very strange because when she would come home on breaks and like when she would even visit me in the city, like sometimes I would feel this distance from her and like from that experience because she's been growing up around these ridiculously wealthy kids. And even trying to, we've had such different experiences because I go to an Ivy League school and like going there when you're 18 is very different than being 14 and knowing that you're not those kids and like not seeing yourself at all in them and knowing that that is not at all your experience and that experience is even to the detriment of people back home. And so I've never, even as somebody who goes to an Ivy League school now, never looked back at, you know, people from East Atlanta or people from Oakland and thinking like, you know, you don't understand like the violence that's happening to you or you don't feel necessarily, you know, like that you don't understand your conditions or that you're not necessarily educated about what's happening to you or that you have a different altered worldview compared to what's happening in like the college process or the real world, because that sort of elite upper view is, I think, what in a way my mother wanted for Treasure and that she probably wanted for all of us, but it was warped and it was it was something that I had, I mean, it was not that difficult for me to unlearn it when I got to Columbia because it was so obviously irreality, but I think that it's something that it worries me when I see like black kids that go through elite, I mean, even black kids at Columbia, I have such difficulty with them because they view the black experience as like, through such a warped lens of like this sort of political space rather than like this very much larger reality that like is, it's so pervasive, like the violence that happens to black people in this country, so much more than just a political conversation, it happens in the household. It's difficult for mothers, for fathers, for any kind of black person to just live in America right now. And I think that there's no sort of, spokesperson or politic that you can take on to speak to it accurately, even if you're talking about black motherhood for that instance, because it's just hard and we're all just trying to survive with dignity. And so yeah, I think that in that it's been very it's been weird for our, it's been not weird, but it's been interesting for our family dynamic.
Let me ask mom.
Ask me.
What's your biggest worry for all the kids, all the children?
It's not, I won't call it a worry because I'm so prayerful. I'm one who prays without ceasing all day. But I think that my biggest concern and a lot, that is the same thing I tell a lot of parents to really be concerned about, is not so much even what's going on in the world or in the country. It's taking care of your children's emotional and mental health. Because no matter what environment they're in, they're still growing and we're still molding and shaping them. But that has been my biggest challenge, is just to be able to take care of their emotional and mental health. Because like even when I wrote this book, I had one child in elementary school, one child in middle school, one child in high school, and an adult child in college at the same time. Yeah. So I was doing what I say, Butch Lewis, you know, rest in peace, used to always say, I was just always spinning plates and trying not to drop one and trying not to break anything. And in the trenches, all of that, all the time in the trenches. And I'm just coming out of the trenches now, but I'm still always concerned about, you know, the things they go through at school, the things they go through in work, concerns and anxieties about future. You know, sadness about past. So it's always taking care of that mental and emotional health so they can do these things that they do. And I absolutely asked Treasure when she was 13, would you consider going to boarding school, because I knew that it would change her life. I knew that it would, if she was offered this opportunity, and I said, if you do well, you know, we'll see. If you do well, and you know, stay. If you don't like it, go. Mm-hmm. But she's getting an education. The things that she learns, you can hear her.
Yeah.
Is so leaps and bounds and mountains above what other children are taught in public school that it's almost criminal. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. They learn at a Harkness table where there's like 8 kids in a classroom. They have discussions. Yeah. They don't have a teacher standing. They have discussions with the teachers. Mm-hmm. So they're taught to be leaders. Mm-hmm. And I knew just because of even what my son, who sometimes they say he's smarter than all three of them put together.
He is.
PJ is so intelligent.
Yeah.
And PJ was able to name capitals of the states, of all 50 states, when he was 3 years old on a blank map.
Yeah.
And he started to read when he was three and
just
signed his name.
Just in case anybody suspects that, I knew PJ when he was three.
Yeah, when he was able to sign his name and get a library card when he was three. And he was the one who gave me this fascination with motherhood and children and raising children and made me love being a mother, mm-hmm. my son. And he's such a good son. And when we were going through all of these struggles, PJ graduated from the University of California at 21, and he worked, and he was paying our rent to take care of us so I could get these kids through. Mm-hmm. And I just wanted the best for them. And her being the youngest and the last, I said, let me just try to get her in the best, safest, most comfortable with all of the bells and whistles. And she was elected class president 3 years in a row.
Yeah.
So, you know
I'm as I sit here, I can never advocate and tell somebody to go buy a book. What I will say is that you were the person to write this book. You were absolutely the person to write this book. Crystal, you've been quiet for a moment, as everyone else has spoken.
I usually am.
And you hear, having heard all of what they said, I just want you to respond.
Respond to?
Of all that Treasure said, and then Bianca's response.
Well, I have had an entirely different experience than both of them because I do go to an HBCU.
Mm-hmm.
Not to say I haven't been around white people, because me and Bianca went to the same high school. We took the same classes for the most part. My classrooms in high school were almost completely white. I was the only black girl for most of high school in the classes I took. Even though it was a predominantly black high school, there were specific, you know, higher level classes with only white kids and then the black girls. My college experience has been completely different, and it's always interesting. I never fully understand what they're going through. It's always like outside looking in, same way I look at like black students that attend Vanderbilt right down the street from Fisk.
Mm-hmm.
And it does, I mean, I
so
can't.
You, because it, to a certain extent, pardon me, you're still in a cocoon.
You're still
in a cocoon. Yes, I love my cocoon.
And I have to go out, you know, I'm a Jubilee singer at Fisk. So I'm constantly interacting on like a business level with people who are not black. But I know that my experience at Fisk is something that I would literally never trade for anything in the world, because unlike these two who have very strong personalities and I think they were very goal driven and knew what they wanted out of life.
Mm-hmm.
Coming out of high school, coming out of Oakland, I had, she can attest to it, no idea what I was doing, where I wanted to be.
Mm-hmm.
And being at Fisk was a very safe environment for me to learn who I was. Mm-hmm. And that's what I have to say on that.
Treasure, at 18, have you figured out what you want to be when you grow up? What you want to do?
What I want to do. I mean, I'm already in the works of doing what I want to do. I do what I want to do all the time in many different ways. I want to study public policy. I'm very much into humanitarianism and things like that. Just last year, I started the licensing for an organization I'd been working on for a while. It's called Operation Time of the Month. I was dispersing feminine hygiene products to shelters back in Oakland and two here, two in New York.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I was applying for a grant, one of the requirements is that you do community enhancement,
mm-hmm.
A community enhancement portion to your organization.
Yeah.
And that component had to come in the form of a course. And so I got signed on to three schools in New York as a part-time lecturer, and I constructed a curriculum with my sponsor organization that provides me my grant, and it was for 9 months. So I did curriculum writing, and then I got in these schools and I taught an intersectional feminist course. And then I added in the original component of dispersing feminine hygiene products. Mm. So we talked about feminine hygiene product inaccessibility and how that relates to intersectionality when you're talking about feminist advocacy. Mm-hmm. And I want to see that grow. I want to continue with that. I want to continue my education.
And just in case folks don't think that you might not ever have any fun, mm-hmm. we've got a video to show something quite different.
Oh my God, no.
That shows a little dance and some spoken word. Can we get that?
What is this?
No one leaves home unless home is the mouth of a shark. You only run for the border when you see the whole city running as well. Your neighbors running faster than you, breath bloody in their throats. And the boy you went to school with who kissed you dizzy behind the old tin factories, holding a gun bigger than his body. You only leave home when home won't let you stay. No one leaves home unless home chases you. Fire under feet, hot blood in your belly. And even then, you carry the anthem under your breath. Only tearing up your passport in airport toilets, sobbing as each mouthful of paper made it clear that you would not be going back. You have to understand, and no one would put their children in a boat unless the sea is safer than the land. No one burns their palms under trains, beneath carriages. No one spends days and nights in the gallbladder of a truck feeding on newspaper unless the miles traveled mean something more than journey. No one crawls under fences, wants to be beaten, wants to be pitied. No one chooses refugee camps or strip searches where your body is left aching, or prison, because prison is safer than a city of fire, and one prison guard in the night is safer than 14 men who look like your father. No one could take it, could stomach it. No one's skin would be tough enough. The go home blacks, refugees, dirty immigrants, asylum seekers, sucking our country dry.
Bianca? If you had an opportunity to choose who you'd like to have dinner with between Michelle Obama and Angela Davis.
Angela Davis, 100%.
I was going to ask you, who would you choose and why?
Well, simple. Angela Davis is revolutionary and Michelle Obama's not.
Opinion writer again.
Well, it's not an opinion. I mean, historically, like if you look at the effect that Angela Davis's actions have had on, access to healthcare, access to humanity and dignity for Black people, like there's really no comparison. Like Michelle Obama is a figurehead for a state, and of course, like she's an amazing Black woman as far as her own accomplishments go, and you can't take those away from her. But she did take a position that has been historically in opposition to the needs and wants of the Black community as far as the presidency, because if you look at the history of the presidency in this country, I mean, we live in the United States of America. I don't need to tell anybody that the presidency is not a resistant or revolutionary position to hold. It's the head of a state. It's the head of an imperial power, which the United States is, like, as we all know. I mean, the United States is still even a colonial power because we own Puerto Rico and other colonies, the Virgin Islands. Yeah, I mean, but there's no need to disparage Michelle Obama because we're both Black women. Angela Davis is Angela Davis. Like, Angela Davis is a revolutionary figure. She's an educator. She's a thinker. I mean, the thing is like, that's what I want to be mm-hmm. when I grow up, is a thinker, honestly. And mm-hmm. like somebody who moves through difficult ideas. And yeah, there is gas when people are just like, Michelle Obama, not revolutionary, not resistant, not the most beautiful, important, amazing Black woman on earth. Like, no. And it's just like, of course, that's hard to stomach, but that's why I'm here, to tell you that that's not really a difficult position to take, to think that Michelle Obama is, you know, the most revolutionary figure on earth. But Angela Davis, like, her work is felt every day in any education system. That actually caters to the needs of Black children, that actually nurtures the Black mind. I mean, to even you can't even talk about intersectional feminism, which has become such a trite an overused term in general, both in academia and culture, without talking about Angela Davis.
I want to hear your sister's thoughts about the 45th president of the United States.
That's Donald
who's,
Trump.
Who's Treasury occupying the office now?
There you go, I don't know.
They're the thoughts.
Yeah?
They're the thoughts.
There's,
there are none.
Yeah.
No thoughts.
To entertain him as a legitimate leader is that's ignorance in and of itself. I don't.
But he is a legitimate leader, elected legitimately by, I mean, the Electoral College is a legitimate institution within the United States, which was always used to protect slavery and used as a, you know, to protect small states, which is really states' rights, which is southern states, which is slavery. And so he is a legitimately elected leader, and we do have to entertain him as a legitimate imperialist, racist, misogynist, because he wields the power of the...
So there's the commentary. Yeah, so he's racist, he's xenophobic, mm-hmm, his policies mm-hmm are non-inclusive.
Yeah, which we knew.
Which we knew.
Yeah.
So...
Yeah.
Right.
Gotcha. Okay. So we are... We're just as we said, a few days away from Mother's Day.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Man, what these girls are gonna do with their lives is something beyond amazing.
I'm still watching.
I would like for you to express how you feel as a mother about where they are and where you know that they're going. Because, look, it doesn't take a rocket scientist that in their own way, each of the three of them are going to make an impact on this world.
Absolutely. I know that all four of my children will in their own ways. And I always told them, I don't really care what you do. Just make the world a better place, whatever you do. I don't care if you're a carpenter. I don't care if you're a teacher, a singer, an artist, a dancer. Just make the world better. Don't consume and complain. Come up with some suggestions. I used to tell them that when they were growing up. Don't come in here just complaining. Mm-hmm. Bring me some suggestions on how to make it better, because I'm not perfect at this. Yeah. I'm still learning how to do this. Yeah. They school me constantly. Yeah. Yeah. I mostly phone counsel with my children now. Mm-hmm. We talk individually, collectively, on the phone, hours and hours every week. And I just get excited to watch them. And I always tell mothers, if you nurture your children properly, and I have this eight wheel of, you know, that I use in my teaching, eight wheel sections of what is proper nurturing. It's not food, clothing, and shelter, like so many of us were raised. I'm feeding you, I'm clothing you, I'm, you know, when you're 18, you're grown, get out. It's for the rest of my life, I'm a mother. It is every day, every moment, they're in my thoughts, in my heart, in my prayers. And I just get excited watching them grow, because I know they're good people, yeah, and I know they're gonna make it all better.
Good and great and wonderful people. We've got 90 seconds left, so I wanna give each of you 30 seconds to tell me what makes you most happy.
Can we start with Christmas?
Start with Christmas.
It's a simple answer for me. Yeah, singing makes me so happy. And I think she was able to see that recently when she came to Nashville and saw me perform at the Ryman. And I had my solo singing Wade in the Water with the Jubilee Singers. And like in those moments when, I mean, I have terrible vision, but when I can feel the audience looking at me and I can see the people that I'm on stage performing with and really just connect in, especially the music that I get to sing. But that is...
Singing.
Singing.
I would say that the possibility of love and other people. I love people so much. And I mean, just in the time that I've been in DC, which has been the last like 12 hours, I've just seen so many characters and connected with so many people. Just on a basic level, I love connecting with people, just seeing eye to eye with them.
Little sister.
I think growth makes me feel very happy, financially growing, like emotionally, like just feeling like I'm getting closer to being the person I'm going to be and overcoming the frustrations of who I am.
The heavyweight champion of the world. of mamas.
What makes me happy makes love makes me happy, and I have it, and I'm getting married this year.
Congratulations.
I'm proud of my children, and it makes me happy to help other parents do this thing. That's
and I've
so got to
say, as we finish here, Happy Mother's Day to all. That wraps us for this evening. For more information on this program or any other program produced by WHUT, go to WHUT.org. Happy Mother's Day, goodbye, and God bless.
This program was produced by WHUT, Howard University Television, and made possible by contributions from viewers like you. Thank you.